it's Duania from Canadian Small Business Women, and thank you for joining us for our monthly chat with Vistaprint and whomever our featured expert is. And this month, it happens to be Shalini, and she is from Dharna CPA. So a little bit about Shalini. Actually, I'll come back a little bit. I'll let Shalini introduce herself, but you can find out more about Shalini on her website, which is
www.dharnacpa.ca.
And you can see all her information on this side of the screen. So she is an expert when it comes to business solutions, tax planning, accounting services, all kind of financials. So she is going to take over right now. I'm going to step back. And at the end, I might jump back in and tell you a little bit more about what she has coming up, or Shalini might do that herself. So yes, help me welcome Shalini.
Hello, Facebook world. So nice to virtually meet all of you. So as Duania mentioned, my name is Shalini and I am the owner of Dharna CPA. I actually work with my father, who's also a CPA and a certified financial planner. So together we are basically your one-stop shop for all your financial needs. Just to kind of let more people get online, I'll start talking a little bit about my background. So I am a CPA, and my background mainly comes from the corporate world. I did audit for a number of years, and I worked as a financial analyst with the Ministry of Education as well. And then after having my son, made some life decisions and decided to join the family business, actually take over the family business. And thus, Dharna CPA was born, and I've basically been doing this now for well over a year. And my area that I focus on is really working with entrepreneurs. My mission is to kind of change the vision that people have when they think of accountants. I'm not that stuffy in a box accountant. I really do think accountants can have personalities, and that's what I want to convey to people. So I do this in a number of ways. It's either one-on-one coaching and consulting, so you can still do your tax returns from whoever you want, but we can still work together vis-a-vis coaching and consulting. We can outsource your bookkeeping and actually help you file your tax returns. Or we can, I have a part-time CFO program, which I can work hands-on in your business with you, helping you understand your numbers and make informed decisions. So why are we here today? Tonight, we are here to talk about taxes. I know everybody loves taxes. It's the time of year that people remember, hey, I need to do all that bookkeeping, all those receipts that I've been collecting and keeping in that shoebox of mine. What do I do with these again? So today we're going to talk about just some tax updates and some common mistakes that a lot of business owners are making and some CRA red flags. So let's start. I'm not going to focus too much on the personal tax side of things, but there is one personal tax change that's effective the 2016 tax year that impacts small business owners as well. So effective in the 2016 tax year, so this tax season, if you sold your house or your principal residence in 2016, going forward you now have to declare that. And so what this is really going to prevent are people who were basically switching over their principal residence for multiple properties, selling it, using that principal residence exemption. Your principal residence is the only thing in the world that you are not taxed on. So when you sell it and you make a profit, you don't get taxed on that profit by using the principal residence exemption. So people were using this on multiple properties and not paying taxes. And so now you have to declare it into your tax return so that it can be kind of tracked, and they'll see how often are you perhaps using that principal residence. So if you've been perhaps buying houses, renovating them, living in them just for the bare minimum, and then selling them, well, really what you're doing is flipping houses as a business, and that's going to be caught. So how does that impact small business owners? Well, the most favorite expense most entrepreneurs like to claim is a home business expense or business use of home expenses. So this is claiming off your mortgage interest, your property taxes, your utilities, etc. And even though the monthly expenses are actually okay to deduct, what some people do is take it one step further, and they will, for example, renovate their home office and install, you know, nice fireplace, crown molding, make it really cozy, and then they'll do something called depreciation. And that's basically taking a portion of the cost of the renovations or of the physical building and bringing it into income as an expense every single year. Well, that's fine, but the rules say that when you actually then sell that property, you have to factor in that depreciation. So what's going to happen is, because you're now declaring the principal residence in your tax returns, for the sole proprietors that are also claiming these a little bit excessive home office expenses, it's going to cause a red flag. And so your tax return can be then flagged to make sure that you actually are claiming it back. The principal residence exemption can actually be denied for a portion of those expenses as well. So homeowners that are using a portion of their home for business purposes, that portion of the house you're basically saying is no longer your principal residence. It's for business purposes, and that's not exempt from taxes. So that can cause a lot of complications for business owners that are using the business use of home expenses. So just a word of caution going forward for business owners with that new rule. So moving forward, I wanted to talk a little bit about some common mistakes that entrepreneurs are making. One of the main things that I see people doing is they're not including their barter transactions. So what does barter mean? I'm sure many of you have probably engaged in a barter transaction without even realizing that you're doing it. So bartering is an exchange of service without the exchange of cash. So I'm an accountant. I might say, hey, I'll do your tax returns and you do my social media and we won't pay each other. We'll just do the services. Well, in the eyes of the CRA, you're still providing a service. Even if cash is not exchanged, you are still providing a service, and so you still need to record those services and those expenses. And so a lot of people, when they're doing barters, they're not actually doing the transaction. They're not putting it through their bookkeeping. So my advice for people is, if you want to do a barter transaction, that's fine, but actually treat it like a real transaction. So I invoice you for my work, you pay me, and you invoice me for your work and I pay you. The end result should be a wash, because if we're doing an exchange of service at agreed upon price, odds are it'll be kind of evened out at the end. But that way, at least it's still recorded in your books and the cash transaction allows it to be easily tracked. And you avoid this whole issue of not recording your barter transactions. Keep in mind, barter transactions should be recorded at fair market value. So you shouldn't really reduce your fees to make it a wash. Charge what your fair market value is, and the other person should charge you what the fair market value is as well. So if you have been doing barter transactions, you now know that those have to be recorded. The other thing that a lot of employers are doing is not recording gifts to employees or gifts that they receive of significant value in their income. So if you give your employee gifts throughout the year and the value of said gifts is over $500, it's actually a taxable benefit. And if you receive the same, it's actually a taxable benefit. So what I see a lot is, for example, people that are in direct sales, they might win that trip to somewhere really sunny and love it this time of year, which is awesome. But that the value of that trip should be included in the T4 or T4A that is issued by your direct sales company. And if it's not, and you don't voluntarily put that value of that trip in there, should you ever get caught, there would be interest and penalties from the date you were supposed to record it. So just be aware that a gift may not always be a gift, and it's $500 throughout the year, not in single increments. So you can't just give, you know, $490 gifts and get away with it. It's $500 value throughout the calendar year, basically. And so basically what will happen is, if you do give such gifts to your employees or you receive it, you would include it in their T4 as part of their income. So that's about gifts. The next thing that I find a lot of people are making mistakes on is they say to me, I don't need an accountant yet. I'm not making any money. Or I'll come to you when I'm making a profit. But the reality is, as soon as the idea of being in business comes into your head, you need to talk to an accountant. The losses, so if you aren't making money, you are making a loss. And those losses can be applied against future profits. So it's really important to be tracking, one, all of your expenses. You want to make sure that you are recording everything that you are incurring for a business purpose. And if it does result in a loss, as long as you can prove that you are trying to make this business work, that you are actively pursuing clients, trying to grow your business, then those losses are okay. The problem happens for individuals that are spending huge amounts of money, incurring losses, but they really can't prove that they're really actively trying to grow their business. So the CRA does want to see that you are working your business. And as long as you can do that, losses are okay. And once you file your taxes to show the loss, what happens is the first year you make a profit, we can apply those losses against the profit. So you're actually deferring taxes a little bit longer. So for anybody who hasn't been filing taxes or not recording all their expenses because they don't want to show a loss, you're really doing yourself a disservice. So the next tip is to really do your bookkeeping, track your expenses. The second the business idea comes into mind and the first dollar you spend, track it. It's going to be in your benefit going forward. The next tip that I have is not tracking how much money you personally are putting into the business. So what do I mean by that? So obviously, as a business grows and generates its own revenue, ultimately the goal is that your business becomes what we call self-sustaining. You want to make sure that you are generating more revenue than expenses so that you don't have to go into debt or take out that line of credit. Now, just be warned, as business owners, the cash flow may not always be there, so having that line of credit as a backup is really important. But until you're at that point where your revenues are more than your expenses, you are probably going to be using one of two sources, either that line of credit or you're going to put in your own personal money into the business. And so that's where we talk about keeping your personal and business separate. You want to track clearly with a paper trail how much personal investments you've put into your business. So what I usually recommend to my clients is, one, open up a separate bank account and then write a check from you to your business. That will clearly show that I invested $10,000, $5,000, however much, into my business, and I'm now putting it into a separate bank account. And by using that separate bank account to keep track of all my business expenses, I'm really keeping that clear line between business and personal. And similarly, if I take money out of my business to pay myself, use a check and actually show a payment from the business to yourself to keep track of how much money you've taken out of the business. So why does this matter? What happens when you sell your business is, again, any sale of a business that is made for a profit, is there's a capital gain. So 50% of the capital gain is taxed. And the way that we calculate that capital gain is we take the fair market value, or the selling price, minus the adjusted cost base, which is basically how much money you've put into the business. And that difference, 50% of that is taxed as a capital gain. So as an example, let's say you sell your business for $100. But if you can't tell me with proof that you actually put in $50 into your business, then you're going to be taxed on $100 versus $50. So that's why it's really important that you keep track of how much money you've put into the business and taken out, because that will impact when you plan on selling. And the sale of a business will happen at two main points in your life. One, you may choose at some point to sell your business. And even if you're in direct sales and you think, oh, what am I selling? It's not my product. It's not really my company to sell. Your client list and your distribution list does have a value, and that can be sold to other people who will then get any residual income that you've been getting. They can buy into it to purchase that client list from you. The other time that you will sell your business is when you die. Any business that you have will be deemed to have been sold upon death. So at that point, it's even more important that we know the cost of your business, because it impacts the family's taxes, or your terminal tax return will be impacted by that. So please do yourself a favor and track how much money you've been putting into the business and how much money you've been taking out of the business. And the easiest way to do that is to have a separate bank account and keep proper bookkeeping records. The next tip that I have is, people don't often record all their transactions because they don't have a proper bookkeeping system. So even if you're in a situation where you really can't afford to outsource and hire a bookkeeper, have a system in place of how you're going to organize your receipts and schedule in time into your schedule, just like you would for a client meeting or to complete client deliverables, to actually do the bookkeeping. And at a bare minimum, there are some free softwares out there that you can use that offer you not a complete accounting picture, but at least they'll do some of it. So for example, I know FreshBooks and Wave Accounting, they're free softwares. They don't offer you full accounting reports, but what they do offer you is still better than doing nothing. If you do want to invest in a software, we recommend QuickBooks. That's what we use in our office. Or if people use Sage Simply Accounting, those are probably the two biggest ones for small business owners that work. And the last resort is to use an Excel spreadsheet to at least track your expenses by the different categories. And at the minimum, you can then give that to your accountant at tax time to fill your business schedules. Now let's talk about HST. So HST is one of those things that people never really know how to treat HST. It's kind of, do I, don't I, when is the right time to be charging HST? So if you go onto the CRA website, the magical number that they have come up with is 30,000. So when your global income from your business reaches $30,000, you are actually required by law to start charging HST on all your sales. And you will start charging it the very first transaction that happens after to hit that 30,000 mark. But you can voluntarily choose to charge HST earlier, from day zero, or from any point in between zero and $30,000 in sales. So why would you do that? The reason why you would do that is if you happen to have a business that has a lot of expenses where you are paying HST, the way that an HST remittance, which is what the HST form is called, the HST remittance will take the HST that you collected on your sales, and you're going to subtract from it the HST that you paid on your expenses. So as an example, I collected $100 in HST. If I add up all the HST I paid and it adds up to $25, I will actually only owe the government $75. Or vice versa, if I only collected $25 but I spent $100, I will then get a $75 refund. So I can only claim the HST I spend, which is called an income tax credit, input tax credit. I can only claim these input tax credits if I am charging HST on my sales. So when should that consideration be taken into point? One, if you are in a situation, like I mentioned, where you have a lot of expenses and your revenue hasn't quite caught up, you might have a period of time where you're actually getting refunds instead of paying. Now keep in mind, hopefully your business is going to grow to such a point where you will be at a point where you are actually collecting more than what you are spending. But at that point, your business has grown so much that you don't care. So what I would recommend in those situations is to keep a separate bank account that you actually spend and put all the money that you've collected into that separate bank account, separate from your main operating bank account, so that come HST time, if you get a refund, yay. And if you happen to owe money because you now are at a point where your sales are more than your expenses, you then have that backup bank account and you're not scrambling last minute to figure out how you're going to pay your HST remittance. The second reason why I would recommend filing or voluntarily claiming HST is because for your clients, it allows a certain consistency. Because if I have a business where I'm expecting recurring clients, if I all of a sudden have to start charging HST, in the mind of the client, it's kind of like a price hike. All of a sudden you're charging me more, when really I might not be charging you more, I'm just charging you tax. It seems like you're charging me more. So by charging HST from the day one, you're just establishing a common price point. You're establishing that you are going to charge tax, and it's something that we do pay in almost everything that we do. So that's another good reason to start collecting taxes or HST earlier. Now, a reason why you may not want to collect HST and voluntarily do it earlier is if those situations don't really apply. If you don't have a lot of expenses and you're not really concerned about that perceived price hike, then administratively you're saving yourself the hassle of having to take out HST in your bookkeeping and not having to file HST remittances. HST remittances can be done either monthly, quarterly, or annually. You can choose at the beginning, and once you owe, I believe the number is more than $1,500, you get forced into doing installments more frequently throughout the year. So that's the gist of HST and the whys and hows to collect and deal with HST on your sales. The next topic I wanted to kind of talk about is employee versus contractor. So a lot of owners, as they are doing their business, they might find themselves in a position where they now need to start hiring some help. And depending on what they're hiring for, they have to make a decision. Is this person really my employee, or is this person a contractor? And the difference is, an employee, you'd put them on payroll, you'd have to pay CPP, EI, and make their income tax deductions, and give them a T4 for tax time. For a contractor, they will give you an invoice for their time or work, however they've agreed upon billing you, and you will pay them. And if they charge you HST, that goes back to that input tax credit we were just talking about. So you can actually claim that as against the money or the HST that you're charging. So what's the difference? The main test, there's a few tests to do when it comes to employee versus contractor, but the main one is, one, how much authority do they have over their work? So if you're telling them what to do, how to do it, when to do it, what tools to use to do it, and you're giving them that much direction, odds are they are an employee. If you are giving them space in your office, if you are giving them the tools, a laptop, a phone, odds are they are an employee. A contractor, conversely, may still come to your premises to work, but odds are you're giving them a task to do and you're relying on their expertise solely, and you may still want to approve their final product, but you're not really telling them how to do it. So I'll use myself as an example. As an accountant, for most people, I am a contractor. They will come to me, they'll give me their shoebox full of receipts. I do the work in my offices. I might ask them questions, they might ask me questions, we'll have a conversation. They'll still approve the final financials because I'm required to have them sign off on it, but they're not really telling me how to do my job. They might have questions, can I deduct this, can we do that? We might talk strategy, but ultimately they're relying on my expertise. This is different from, say, hiring an in-house accountant that is going to be working exclusively on that particular client 40 hours a week. They would have an office, a computer, and be responsible to do the reporting up to, say, a CFO or to the owner. So it's that very clear distinction of, I, as a contractor, am doing work in my office. We might have conversations, but you're not really questioning what I'm doing, versus having office space given to me and being questioned on what I'm doing and the results I'm providing. So if you do have somebody that you're not sure, odds are they're probably an employee. And so the onus is really on the employer to make that classification and to make that proper determination. You're the one, the employer's the one that's going to have to pay the penalties of CPP and EI if that situation is not handled properly. The flip side for some business owners such as yourselves is when you're taking on a job, you might have to question, am I this person's employee and therefore should I be on their payroll, or am I just a contractor? So I'll give the example of perhaps a fitness instructor. You might be a fitness instructor and working at various gyms teaching their classes. You have multiple clients, but for each particular location, they're telling you when your class is scheduled, you're using their facility, and you're using their equipment. So for really, even if you're doing it just 1 hour a week, you are their employee for that 1 hour. And so your time should be recorded into payroll. Or another example is teachers. Sometimes you might be a part-time teacher. You might be hired to come in and teach a course somewhere. But if the curriculum that you're teaching, if what you're teaching, how you're teaching, and the tools to do that teaching is provided to you, you are more likely than not an employee. Flip that to perhaps, say, someone who works in social media. I might hire you. You might come into my office to do the work, but if you're bringing your own laptop, you have your own software, and you're only working perhaps in my office so that we can have a conversation face-to-face versus it being over video chat, then really you're just using my offices, but you've brought your own computer, you own your own programs, and you're doing it for multiple clients, and therefore you are truly a contractor. So
I'm gonna give you a break.
Oh, sure. Dwayne is gonna come in and give me a little bit of a break.
Just so that Shalini can sip her tea for, you know, 30 seconds, because it's quite a bit to talk about. But while she is doing that, I just want to interject and tell you a little bit about what she has coming up. So she does have a Deduct This workshop coming up. There are two opportunities now. There's one in person. It's going to be this Friday at the Stir Kitchen in Mississauga. So if you are local, then please do take advantage of that. I believe registration ends tonight.
I extended it to tomorrow at noon just for the benefit of the viewers coming, and I have a promo code that I will give to everybody for 15% off at the end of the chat as well.
All right, so you heard it here, 15% off. The registration has been extended until tomorrow, so we will be putting some information up underneath this video. There's also another opportunity in March. There is an online version, so we will post all the information here so that you can get through to Shalini to ask her some questions, because I know sometimes it can be a little bit getting the information and you have so many questions that you want to ask, but some of them might be personal. So you can find a way to, you know, come in, have a consult. You know, there's always Zoom, so you can talk to each other. But definitely I wanted to give Shalini a little break. Now, enough of me. Back to Shalini.
Thanks, Duania. And I just wanted to add, so the workshop, it is going to go over a lot of these things, and there will be more visuals. Accounting is one of those things that's very hard to just talk about. It's numbers, it's theories, it's concepts. So the in-person and the online, there will be kind of nice PowerPoints with some pictures and graphics. And what's included in the workshop is also a free 30-minute consult with me. So a lot of these topics, they're great to understand the theory, but if you're really wondering, how do I apply it to my business? Well, a free 30-minute consult is included in the workshop cost, and that way we can answer your specific questions and understand your specific needs. So we're going to keep on going. If you do have any questions, please post them. I can see the comment feed that's going on. So if you do have a question, feel free to post it, even if it's specifically about your business. We can try and have that kind of a conversation, obviously not getting into specifics, but maybe offering some generic advice that can benefit you and your business. So the next thing that I find a lot of business owners, they're not really doing, is this concept called estate planning. So estate planning is basically planning for your death. I know it's a morbid topic, people don't like to think about it, but the reality is it's a reality of life. You're going to die at some point. And the problem is, the complication is that once you have a business, your estate becomes that much more complicated. And so if you haven't taken the time to do estate planning and you haven't taken the time to figure out this business of mine, what's going to happen if I'm not here? How am I going to perhaps pass it on to my children in the most tax efficient way? Or at what point should I perhaps sell it? We can cover all of those questions in estate planning. Now, some of you might be thinking, estate planning, isn't that something I do with a lawyer? And the reality is we actually work with your lawyer. It's a you need the accountant for the tax strategies and you need the lawyer to actually draw up the legal aspect of it. So most typically you will have an accountant and a lawyer working on your estate. And you want to make sure you update your will as well. So if you do have a will or if you don't have a will, definitely get one and in your will dictate what's going to happen to your business. The other mistake I find a lot of business owners don't do is have their processes written out so that let's say you fall sick, something happens and you're unable to do your job and you're unable to meet your client needs. You don't want those clients to necessarily have to go find someone else and you don't want to lose the business because you're ill. But if you do happen to have your processes written out and a backup, perhaps it's partnering up with somebody in the same business as you so that you can help each other out if there's work overload. Or perhaps it's just having some basic processes written out so that at the very least somebody can go and send an email to say, you know what, I know this needs to be done, but here's how we're making sure that it's not going to get delayed. Having that process, having that conversation with the people that would perhaps be taking over should you fall ill or get injured or need to take time off for whatever reason, that's all part of the planning process. So it's something you don't want to think about. It's something that we never really plan for until it's too late. So my advice is to take the time and come up with that plan. Write down the process. Have your client list somewhere. You know, if you fall sick and I need to contact your client on your behalf, where am I going to get that information? Perhaps you have a document with passwords written down that you give to somebody that you trust, similar to like a power of attorney, so that, you know, you have a client deliverable that has to be done. You've taken an advance payment. You don't want to have to pay it back. We can still keep your business going, even if you are not physically able to do that. So, oh, I have a question here. What is the form number which deals with recording expenses and revenues for income tax purposes? So for sole proprietors, that form is called a Schedule 2125. It's included within your personal tax return. So that form itself is about, I want to say, 16 different parts to it and about 9 pages long. And so you fill that out as a schedule within your personal tax return. So let's talk about some CRA red flags. Nobody likes getting audited by the CRA, but it does happen. It's happened to me. And I'm sure there's many of you out there that have had the fun task of working with CRAs to prove what you filed. So there's a couple of things that will impact whether you get audited by the CRA. So the first thing is large or unusual changes. So especially for those of you that have perhaps left recently a corporate job or a full-time job and are now embarking upon sole proprietorship, that's a change in your tax return. All of a sudden you were making, you know, a salaried income and now you're showing small business income. So that's a red flag. It doesn't necessarily mean you'll be guaranteed to be audited, but it is a trigger. If you claim a lot of business use of home expenses, so that's another area that we talked about earlier in this chat, but the CRA really doesn't like you using business and personal and mixing it together. So if a significant amount of your expenses is because of a business use of home, that's a red flag. And also something to note, you actually cannot use business use of home expenses to create a loss. So what you're actually supposed to do is take all your income, all your deductions except for the home office expenses, and see where you're at. If you're already at a loss, technically you're not supposed to use the home expenses to increase your loss. It's something I don't find a lot of business owners are actually following, but that is an issue and that is cause for a red flag in the eyes of the CRA. The next red flag is excessive business use of vehicle. So we all know we can write off the kilometers that we drive for business purposes. But if that's a significant amount of expenses for you, again, that's a red flag. Claiming a lot of meals and entertainment. Meals and entertainment is probably the most abused expense small business owners do. Everyone loves to go out for coffee or lunch dates with their friends or potential prospect clients and write it off. And we do that a lot for in our networking, in our meetings. And if you're doing that a lot and it's a significant expense, especially compared to how much you've earned, that's a red flag. If you do it a lot and it's with the same person, that's a red flag, unless that person happens to be a client. But even then, how often are you really taking a client out for a meal? So what I like to recommend, at least when it comes to meals and entertainment, if you're just meeting someone to kind of feel them out, go for a coffee. A $2 coffee is a lot cheaper than perhaps going out for lunch. And a tip for every single meal is, one, you need to keep the detailed receipt, the one that actually shows what was purchased. And on that receipt, if you can, staple their business card, or at least at a minimum, write down the name of the person you were meeting and the purpose of the meeting. So whether it was a networking event, get to know each other, coffee date, because what happens when you get audited, the CRA will look at the receipts and ask you, what was this meal for? And especially depending on how many years possibly it's been since you incurred that coffee or that meal, you won't remember. So writing it on the receipt is a great way for you to be like, oh, I met so-and-so for coffee to talk about potentially doing business together. Then you don't forget. I see there was a question here that says, can't a contractor or business owner register for EI? And the answer is yes. That is a relatively new thing that has been allowed, that now as a contractor or as a self-employed individual, you can opt in to pay into EI. Why would you do this? Well, EI, employment insurance, is something that what happens is you can't work for whatever reason, you're injured, you go on mat leave, or you shut down your business. It's unfortunately not a viable business. When that happens, you can then claim and go register for EI. But if you haven't been paying into EI, you can't claim EI. So a lot of self-employed people kind of complained to Service Ontario and the CRA that we have no options. We're trying to run our businesses, but if it doesn't work or we need to take time off, we're financially hurting. And so what the CRA has now allowed in the last few years is that you can actually voluntarily contribute into EI. CPP is not an option. If you are taking money out as a salary, you are required to pay the CPP and income taxes on that salary. So CPP has always been there, but EI is something that you can do in the last few years.
There's another question. Did you see that?
So this is a follow-up from the previous question. So is this new, like this year? No, it's been there for about a few years. I don't know exactly when this ability to put into EI started, but it definitely is not current. It's probably been there for at least the last 4 to 5 years, as far as I know.
There's another question that said, how do you deduct costs for your home office?
Okay, so costs for your home office is effectively what the easiest way to do it is. So you're going to add up all your home office expenses. So that's your utilities, your hydro, your water, your internet, your mortgage interest, just the interest, not the principal payments, and any other home office expenses. And then you take the square footage of your home office space divided by the square footage of the house, and that gives you the basic calculation. You're then actually supposed to take it one step further and multiply that by how often you're using the home office space. So they really only want you to deduct it for the amount of time that you're spending in it. Most people, in my experience, don't necessarily take it to that second step, but per the CRA guidelines, you are supposed to actually calculate how often the percentage of time being spent in there too. It has to be a designated area. in your home. So you can't just say, oh, I use my coffee table for business purposes. No, it should be a separate room. And you need to be able to prove that you're using it to meet clients or customers, or that you need it to run your business. And so for a lot of people that are always out and they're meeting clients really at coffee shops, they're not doing phone conferences, they're not doing phone meetings, and they're just kind of, they have the office, but they're not really working from the office, I caution you strongly against claiming home office expenses. It's, unless you can really prove that you're using it for business purposes to meet clients, it's just one of those things that if it gets denied, whatever interest and penalties you would have are based on what you owed as of the date you should have made that claim. So what do I mean by that? So let's say in 2016, you get audited and expenses from 2010 have been denied now. The interest and penalties will be calculated as of 2010. So it'll be 6 years worth of interest and penalties for any denied expenses. And the denied expenses would obviously increase the taxes that you owe. So that's home office. If you actually go onto the CRA website, they do have an entire section on business use of home, and there are some sample calculations there as well. So I think, was that all the questions?
Yeah.
Okay, so gonna keep on trucking. We've got about 20 minutes left and still quite a few things to get through, but we'll see how well we do. So we were talking about CRA red flags and things that are perhaps in your tax return that might put a red flag up on the CRA system and possibly cause a CRA audit. The other thing is recurring business losses. So we've talked a little bit about losses, but if you are in a business and year after year after year after year after year you're showing losses, the CRA doesn't like that. The CRA understands that the first few years, most businesses do have losses. It takes time for the brand to grow. It takes time for your client list to grow, and it takes time for revenues to catch up with expenses. But eventually, the CRA wants to see profits. Now, there's no magic number. I can't say, you know, after 5 years, they want to see profits. But they might question, you know, 6, 7, 8 years of losses. They might question it and ask you to prove that you're actually in an active business. What are you doing to really grow your business? What are you doing to really generate a profit? Because the whole purpose of being in a business really is to generate profit. And if you are incurring losses in as a sole proprietor, and that's actually reducing your personal taxes owed, that's something that the CRA doesn't like. So if you are going to go into business, please try to keep that in mind. Again, you want to record all your losses if you are truly and legitimately in this business to grow it and make it a real business and a profit generator. But if you are someone who is perhaps just doing this for some pocket change, some extra money for residual income, just be careful of having excessive losses. And this is really hard for people that are in direct sales. And the reason why it's a harder issue for people in direct sales is because you are putting the same amount of effort as I am in growing my business. You're going to the same networking events. You're going paying the same amount for perhaps social media, web hosting, all of those things. And you're only getting a commission. So your revenue to expenses are very disproportionate until you get to a point that you have enough of a downline that the residual income makes that catch up. So it's very careful, you'd be very careful, especially if you're in direct sales. Still, like I said, do record that income. But if you know you're really only doing this product or this direct sales company for residual income and you're not, it's not your primary business, you may want to be careful about actually treating it like a business. So I saw that there was another question. The other question is, what EI benefits are there for contractors other than illness and pregnancy? Do loss of work or contracts qualify too? So losing a client itself, no. But let's say your business goes under and you actually shut down your business, similar to being laid off as you would in a employee world, that would count. But if you just lose money, if you've lost a client and therefore you're incurring losses, No, unfortunately, that situation doesn't count. But let's say, so illness, pregnancy, and actually having to shut down your business or take an extended time away from your business, that would count. But just loss of work, specifically as a one client or one customer, and having to incur losses because that one customer or client has left you, unfortunately, no, that would not qualify for filing for EI. I think that was all the other questions. Okay, so those are the CRA red flags. So what happens, how does the CRA really choose who they audit? So there's a number of reasons why your particular income tax return might be chosen for a CRA audit. And these include, one, there is an element of random selection. Two, they will compare the information on your returns to other third-party information and other people consistent in your industry. So for example, if you say you're an engineer and you're making significantly lower or significantly higher than other engineers, that would be a red flag. And they might question, well, why are you making not par value to as other people that are in the same industry? And just comparing other information that you have provided in your returns from year over year even. So if every single year you have been claiming, if you have not ever claimed something before and all of a sudden now you are claiming it, that is a red flag. And that could be a reason for them to audit you and audit specifically that particular item and say, well, you're now claiming public transit, or you're now claiming interest, you're now claiming whatever, please provide the support. And as we've already talked about, the types of deductions or the credits that you're claiming on your personal tax return, that too will be potentially a red flag. So a lot of people think, oh, I've received my notice of assessment, I'm clear, I'm not getting audited. But actually, they have until 6 years to audit you. So I actually just had a client in 2016, they were audited for information in their 2010 return. And in that particular situation, it was actually they did not declare gift cards that they received in their business. So one of their vendors or suppliers gave them a gift card of a significant amount of money. We're talking thousands of dollars. And what most likely happened is that that particular supplier got audited. They gave a list of all the people that they've given gift cards to. And so then everybody on that list was then targeted. And she could not prove that they had actually recorded that gift card as income. And so that gift card amount was added to their tax return in 2010, and they were charged interest and penalties for 6 years. So just because you receive your notice of assessment does not mean that you cannot still be audited. And audits can happen in one of two ways. They can either come to your place of business and actually look at your records, or sometimes they'll just send you can just send them the information electronically. It really depends on what the audit is targeting. Are they and what expenses are they asking to look for? So is there a particular way that your receipts should be categorized? It depends. So if you're going to be doing it yourself, so do it yourself, and you're going to just give your accountant the information at the end of the year, then really all I need to know is the total revenues and the total expenses by categories. And those categories are the CRA business categories, because those are each of the line items that I need to record in your tax return. Now, and the other thing that I would need to get from you is any outstanding payables, receivables, and any assets that you have. So what are assets? Assets are things of value that you purchase, usually large ticket items that are going to be used for a multiple number of years to generate income. So we're talking perhaps computers, equipment, and large furniture and equipment. So those things are actually written off throughout a period of time. And depending on what the item is, the CRA has different guidelines as to how the length of time to depreciate it. So I need to know that information. I need to know what your assets are, how much depreciation has already been claimed, any additions you have in the year or disposals, your outstanding payables, receivables, your revenues, and your expenses by category. Now, if you're going to outsource your bookkeeping, that changes things. As a bookkeeper, the way that we do bookkeeping is different than the way that we expect it to be given. If you're going to be giving me your bookkeeping, I expect to have all your invoices and expenses categorized by month. You don't need to put them into categories. I will do that. I then just need it organized monthly. So the answer is kind of two-part to that question, because it depends on, are you doing your own bookkeeping or are you outsourcing the bookkeeping? So we have another question. I have a home office I used to work from home, but not to meet clients. Can I still claim partial home expenses? So that's not a black and white answer. We would have to have a conversation of why you need that home office. What were you doing there? Why do you think you should be able to claim it? And how can you support it as a business use? So it, depending on what the answers to that are, I might say, okay, you can probably get away with it. Or you know what? You can, but if you get audited, you can't justify why you needed that home office. So it would probably be denied. So unfortunately, I cannot answer that as a yes or no answer right now. Any other questions? I think I got all of them. So we've got about 10 minutes left. So the other things, if you're wondering what are the different expenses, you can, the CRA website is pretty good about offering you information, and if you actually click on each link, it gives you some descriptions and offers you sample calculations sometimes as well. The other option, as I mentioned, is deduct this. So deduct this is, we're going to be going over all these topics and more. We're going to go in detail over every single expense category that there is, and we're going to talk about how to calculate them, how to document them, and some of those questions you need to ask yourself as to whether or not you should actually claim these expenses. We're going to talk about the pros and cons. We've already talked about the fact that they're now going to be asking you to record principal residence. So if you do have a home office, what are some pros and cons you need to think of when claiming home office? We're going to go over these common mistakes a bit more in detail, and we're going to talk about how to get tax ready. So I am offering all the viewers here today a 15% off code, and the code is Shalini VIP. And so if you use Shalini VIP, you'll get 15% off the ticket price. I have extended the registration until tomorrow at noon for the in-person event, which is happening this Friday. The cost regularly is $75 plus tax, and that includes a two-course lunch, and it's about a four-hour workshop that we're going to be going together. And you also get a free 30-minute consult with me afterwards to talk about your specific situations. And you will also get a free Excel workbook that I give to my clients that are doing their own bookkeeping. Or keep in mind, an Excel spreadsheet is not really doing bookkeeping, but you can use it to help track your expenses and prepare it so that you are giving something to your accountant. So you get the free Excel spreadsheet, you get 30-minute chat with me, and if you use the code Shalini VIP, you get an extra 15% off. So with the last 5 minutes, I thought I'd give it back over to Dwayne to talk about upcoming events and items.
Sure. I feel like I'm getting a lot of close-up today between the seminar and this chat, but thank you everyone for being a part of this. And I'm going to try not to use my hands too much because Kelly told me that, well, Kelly's really that way when you're sitting by me. Well, Kelly told me not to. So other things we have coming up, we do have another chat coming up next month. The date would be March, whatever the Wednesday is. I believe it's March 28th. And it will be featuring HR professionals from the staff room, which is an HR placement agency here in the GTA. They are actually located, I believe it's in Oshawa, but I can double check that. So there will be more information coming up on that soon. And we have quite a few events coming up for this year, so please do remember to go to our website, canadiansmallbusinesswomen.ca, to find out more about what we have coming up. And yes, I believe that is it. Is there anything I'm missing? I doubt it. But yes, have a good night. Thank you very much, Shalini, for all this information. That we are going to rewatch this video and make sure that we record everything that we need. And on the site, there are a lot of links underneath this video that will, you know, take you to get the forms and things like that that Shalini discussed. And you can also read Shalini's blogs. They will be posted on the, I believe it's the 21st, the 20th of each month. There is a blog post. So something, you know, light reading. And yeah, thank you again.